spaces of all the functions.
Thank you for introduction. First of all, I'd like to thank to the organizers for giving me opportunity to talk in this conference. This is my first visit, and it is my pleasure to talk in Seoul. So I'm now going to talk on the analyticity of the Stock semigroup in spaces of bounded functions. Especially, I'd like to talk about the angle of analytic semigroup. So my talk is based on a joint work with Professor Giga and Professor Matthias Heber. Let me start with the Stokes equation. So we here consider the Dirichlet boundary condition to the velocity. The omega is the domain in n-dimensional Euclidean space with n is greater than 2. B is the velocity and Q is the pressure. B0 is the given initial data. The ST denotes the Stokes semigroup. This is the solution operator from initial data to the solution velocity, so-called Stokes semigroup. And it is known that the Stokes semigroup forms the analytic semigroup in LR solenoidal vector space. So I'm now going to talk on the analyticity of this Stokes semigroup in L infinity. Next slide, please. So the analyticity of the semigroup in L infinity was first proved by Desch, Heber, and Purius for a half space by explicit calculation to the solution operator to the resolvent problem, and later by another solution formula to the non-stationary Stokes equation. It is also proved by Solonikov and Malemonti, Starita. We first consider its analyticity on the space C0 sigma. C0 sigma is the L infinity closure of all smooth solenoidal vector fields compactly supported in domain omega. This is bounded and uniformly continuous and decaying when the domain is unbounded. Recently, we considered a contradiction argument to prove its analyticity for what we call admissible domain, for instance, for bounded domain. So let me explain our heuristic idea. Next slide. We considered a priori L infinity estimate. Here is our a priori L infinity estimate. We estimate capital N denotes a norm or a solution up to second derivatives, including a pressure term. And this norm is a scale invariant norm in parabolic rescaling. So we estimate the supernorm of capital N between 0 and sufficiently small time 0 by a supernorm of initial data. And this constant is depending on domain omega and time t0, but independent of initial data. So by showing this a priori estimate, we prove its analyticity. So here is a definition of analytic semigroup in a Banach space X and a given semigroup tt. We say a semigroup is analytic in the sense that if there exists a constant C such that its derivative is bounded from above by constant over t, t is near the origin, this norm is an operator norm, then we say a semigroup is analytic. We define an analytic semigroup from a semigroup. So this estimate is a sufficient condition to extend the semigroup in some sector in the complex plane by Taylor expansion using a semigroup property. So this definition is enough for analyticity. However, it's not enough for the angle. Next slide, please. So we say if a semigroup has an analytic continuation to some sector, the complex plane with angle theta, then we say analytic semigroup is angle theta. A type analytic semigroup is angle theta. So, however, we only know this angle is positive because information about angle depends on this constant. So, we proved by a contradiction argument. So, we only know this constant is just finite. So our motivation is what is the angle of this analytic semigroup on L infinity, for instance on C0 sigma. So the aim of our aim is to clarify this angle. So we prove the angle is pi over 2 as well as on LP. So let us consider, let us give a direct proof for this analyticity result. So we now consider the resolvent problem. Lambda is a complex parameter, and sigma theta delta is a sector in the complex plane. Angle is theta. Theta is between pi over 2 and pi, and delta is some positive constant. The lambda is now greater than delta. So we estimate the supernorm of resolvent of this form. So here is our goal of resolvent estimate. We estimate the supernorm resolvent by a supernorm external force F. The capital MP is the norm for solution up to second derivative. So this estimate, this norm is similar to the norm capital N, but slightly different. So let me write a norm capital MP to remember. So we frequently use this norm capital MP equal lambda Vx plus lambda 1 over 2 gradient B plus lambda n over 2p gradient square B LP. And pressure term. This is the second derivative term. So omega x lambda is an intersection with an omega intersection of of omega with an open ball centered at x x with radius lambda. So we do not estimate the supernorm of second derivative because second derivative is no longer bounded. So we adjust it, we modify it to the uniformly local LP norm, and we estimate this quantity, the supernorm of this quantity, by a supernorm of external force F with p for p greater than n. So our approach is inspired by a corresponding approach for general elliptic operator. It was first proved by Masuda and generalized to Dirichlet boundary condition and more general boundary condition by Stewart. Basically, we appeal to this Masuda-Stewart method. So, next slide. So, to apply this Masuda-Stewart argument, we invoke the pressure estimate by velocity. This is a key. Also, we prove by a contradiction argument. We estimate the supernorm of gradient Q with a distance function d omega by a supernorm of gradient B on the boundary. This constant is depending on domain omega, but independent of V and Q. So, d omega is a distance function from the boundary. And this pressure estimate is a key, and this estimate can be viewed as a regularizing type estimate for the Neumann problem. Take a divergence to the Stokes equation. So, So then we observe that pressure is a harmonic function in a domain omega and multiply a unit outward vector field. Then we see Neumann data is Laplace B times n omega. Here we do not use the, invoke the Dirichlet boundary condition. We only use the fact that normal trace of velocity is zero on the boundary.And by the divergence free condition, we transform this Neumann data into a surface divergence form. When the space dimension is 3, W is tangential trace of vorticity. So our question is, for what kind of domain this estimate holds? Next slide. So now we consider the Neumann problem of this form.P corresponds to pressure and W corresponds to vorticity. If there exists a constant C such that gradient, the supernorm of gradient P is the omega is bounded by the supernorm of W on the boundary for all tangential vector field W, then we say a domain omega is admissible domain, strictly admissible domain.And up to now, we know bounded and exterior domains of C3 boundary are admissible domain. And of course, half space is admissible. However, layer domains are not admissible domain because we can take a pressure by a linear function. If a pressure is a linear function to the tangential direction, of course, it's harmonic function and normal trace, normal velocity is.Normal derivative is zero. So if this estimate were true, we are able to take W is W, so the right hand side is zero, while the left hand side is constant. So, so layer type domains are not admissible domain. So by using this pressure estimate, we are able to estimate the resolvent. Here is main result. Let omega be a strictly admissible domain, is uniformly its boundary. For theta between pi over 2 and pi, there exists a constant delta and c such that the supernorm of resolvent is bounded from above by a supernorm of external force F, provided that P is greater than N. So, so once we have this estimate, now we are going to observe the generation result. So, we are going to define.The Stokes operator in space of bounded functions. Next slide, please. So we define the Stokes operator by showing the invertibility of the resolvent. Next slide.
Can you give us just an example
of admissible domain? Do you have some intuition for that? Bounded domain and exterior domain is admissible domain.
So is
it really related to
the regularity of the boundary? Or what differentiate, you know, these two things?
So you mean exact definition?
I don't know, intuitive.
I'm hoping C3, we can reduce the regularity, but for a moment, we need C3 regularity.So we conjecture that any unbounded domain is strictly admissible domain if and only if a domain is quasi-cylindrical. Quasi-cylindrical domain is layer type domain. So our conjecture. This is our conjecture if and only if omega is not quasi-cylindrical domain. So This means that not layer type domain. And it is known that on the quasi-cylindrical domain, it is known that Poincaré type is, Poincaré estimate holds. This is but conjecture. So, thank you for comments. So, can I go ahead? So now we are going to define the Stokes operator. The first step is injectivity of the resolvent. So injectivity means that if velocity is zero, so R lambda is the solution operator to the resolvent problem. This is the solution operator from external force to the solution velocity. So R lambda is injective. It means that if V is zero, F is zero. This means that R lambda is injective. So we are now we invoke the pressure estimate again. Velocity is zero means that pressure is this pressure estimate implies that if velocity is zero, then pressure is zero. So F is zero. Then we have kernel R lambda is injective. So by restricting the range of this resolvent, the R lambda can be may be regarded as a surjective operator. So R lambda is injective, invertible. So there exists the open mapping theorem implies the existence of the closed operator A such that lambda minus A inverse is agrees with R lambda. So we call this operator A, this closed operator A, Stokes operator in C0 sigma. So let us observe the generation result. So let omega be a strictly admissible domain with uniformly sheets boundary in n-dimensional Euclidean space with n is greater than 2. Then the Stokes operator A generates a C0 analytic semigroup on C0 sigma of angle pi over 2. So now I'm going to explain about the space L infinity sigma, which is greater than C0 sigma. So if you have a comment, please. So let me go ahead. So how long I have?
20 minutes.
20 minutes, okay. So next, please. So next, consider the space L infinity sigma. The space L infinity sigma is greater than C0 sigma. This is discontinuous and non-decaying, and only normal trace is zero. Since we do not know the existence of a solution for non-decaying external force external force F, so we need an approximation lemma. Here's our approximation lemma. In a domain omega, there exists a constant C such that for any non-decaying function F, there exists a compactly supported smooth solenoidal vector field such that the approximate sequence converges to F in the pointwise topology, keeping the uniform super bound. So if we do not care about the divergence free condition, it is easy to construct such a sequence by just cutting off the function and its modification. However, because of the divergence free condition, so it is a non-trivial problem. However, this is valid for bounded and exterior domains. So we now restrict the our generation result for bounded and exterior domains. So next slide. So next is this is the last theorem. Let omega be a bounded or exterior domain with C3 boundary. Then the Stokes operator generates a non-C0 analytic semigroup on L infinity sigma of angle pi over 2. So since to prove the pressure estimate, to prove the admissibility of a bounded exterior domain, we need C3 regularity. That's the reason why we need C3 boundary. And the definition of the Stokes operator is the same as we did for the space C0 sigma. But the point is the semigroup is not C0 semigroup on L infinity because by a smoothing effect of parabolic equation, solution will be smooth even if we start with discontinuous initial data. The Schiller semigroup means that every initial data solution converges to initial data uniformly. So if it were Schiller semigroup, any initial data would be continuous. That's the reason why analytic semigroup is not Schiller semigroup on L infinity. So it is natural to restrict the space so that the semigroup is Schiller semigroup. So now we consider the space BUC sigma. This is a closed subspace closed subspace of bounded uniformly continuous functions such that divergence F is zero and F is zero on the boundary. So when the domain is bounded, the space C0 sigma agrees with the space BUC sigma. So it forms a Schiller semigroup. This is the first proved by Malemonti. And when the domain is for exterior domain, when the domain is an exterior domain, BUC sigma is strictly greater than Schiller sigma. But we are able to prove its continuity at time zero. So I have several remarks. The first remark is about the angle of analytic semigroup. So we first considered a priori upper bound of this form. However, the angle does not follow from this estimate. On the other hand, this estimate is stronger than the resolvent estimate. So this estimate does not follow from resolvent approach because we cannot estimate the supernorm of second derivative for the resolvent problem. So I will explain later. And second remark is about the other boundary condition. Next slide. We observe that our argument applies to Roban boundary condition. So BB is a tangential part of velocity plus tangential part of stress vector. DB is a deformation tensor. And alpha is a parameter. The case alpha infinity corresponds to the Dirichlet boundary condition. And alpha is zero is the Neumann boundary condition. And on the space for half space, it is known that under the subject to the Roban boundary condition, the Stokes operator generates analytic semigroup on L infinity sigma, not in C0 sigma. So last remark is the about large time behavior. When the domain is bounded via the energy inequality, we know that the Stokes semigroup forms a bounded analytic semigroup on L infinity sigma. Here I mean bounded analytic semigroup in the sense that both semigroup and its derivative is globally bounded in globally in time. So for exterior domain, recently Malemonti proved that the Stokes semigroup is bounded semigroup on L infinity. So from now, I'm going to explain our brief sketch of our argument. So our basic idea is to combine this Master Set method and pressure estimate. Here is our goal. This is our key pressure estimate. So basically, Master Set method can be divided into the following three steps. So the first step is localization part. We localize a solution in the domain by multiplying a cutoff function. Then, localized function solves the resolvent equation and with inhomogeneous divergence free condition. And external force and inhomogeneous divergence data contains error terms occurring in the cutoff procedure. And we estimate these error terms in second step. This is key step. And finally, by the interpolation argument, we estimate the soup known of resolvent. So let me explain from the first step. The first step is the localization part. So first step is localization part. Take an arbitrary point x0 in a domain omega and radius r and parameters eta and localize in a domain and take a cutoff function theta 0 so that theta 0 takes 1in an open ball centered at x0 with radius r and theta 0 takes 0 always 0 outside of a ball with radius eta plus 1 r. eta plus 1 r.So then we set omega prime. Omega prime is a localized domain intersection with ball centered at x0 with radius eta plus 1 r. So here is a localized domain.So then, the localized solution, U and P solve the resolvent equation. And we take a constant Q, we change a constant Q on each localized domain. And we take this constant again later. Then, H and G are explicitly given by as follows.So here, so this term is the original external force, and this term is error terms. This term is also error terms. And we apply LP estimate with inhomogeneous divergence free condition, proved by Professor Halbig and Zhou. So we now estimate these error terms. But the estimate for B, error terms B, is the same as for Laplacian.However, we have error terms of pressure. Our question is how to estimate this error terms of pressure. Next slide. This is the second step. So here, let me simplify my presentation to give a heuristic idea of argument by just focusing on estimate for H. So we estimate of H of this form. So,How much I have?
15 minutes.
Okay. So, so let me go back a slide. Yeah, here is a H F theta minus 2 gradient B gradient theta 0 minus.B グラディエントシータ0プラス Q マイナス QC グラディエントシータ0 and our goal is to estimate the LP norm of this form and let me show one of this so this term so we estimate グラディエント B グラディエントシータ take a LP normin omega prime and we just the estimate for the term of B is easy by just taking a soup norm eta plus 1 r over some constant and volume term eta plus 1 r n over p and gradient the soup norm of gradient BYeah, we use the estimate of cutoff functions. So we take a cutoff function theta 0 by rescaling a smooth function theta around the point x0 with scaling eta plus scaling power eta plus 1r. So if we take a derivative once, then we have 1 eta and 1r. If we take a derivative twice, then we have double of them. This constant k is a uniform constant, independent of parameters eta and radius r. So this estimate of this term estimate corresponds to this term. So if we take a derivative once, then we have eta plus 1, eta plus r. And this term is from volume term, volume of omega prime. So the omega prime is included in this ball. Just to take a soup norm. So our question is how to estimate this this error terms of pressure. So we now invoke the pressure estimate by velocity. Next slide. So a key is to apply Poincaré-Sobolev type inequality. This bracket means the mean value of function phi. And the right hand, this norm denotes the soup norm, is a distance function. So if we replace the norm in the right hand side by the LP norm of gradient phi, this estimate is nothing but Poincaré inequality. The Poincaré-Sobolev inequality implies that even if gradient phi is not in LP, function phi may in LP. So, for instance, when the domain omega is an open ball centered at x0 with radius 1, log is in LP, even if its gradient is not in LP or any p. So we apply this Poincaré-Sobolev type inequality for pressure estimate. Next slide, please. So we take a constant QC by a mean value of pressure in a localized domain. And the first estimate is we apply the Poincaré inequality to pressure. Then we have the first estimate. And we estimate the soup norm of gradient Q by using a strictly admissibility of a domain. So we estimate of the soup norm of gradient Q by a soup norm of gradient B. Then we have this estimate. So once we have a pressure estimate, once we establish this error estimate, so it is easy to complete the proof. Next slide. So the last step is interpolation argument. We estimate the soup norm by the Sobolev embedding. So this is the Sobolev inequality, and this exponent appears by a dilation argument. We apply this Sobolev inequality by taking phi by a u and gradient u, and we now take r so that r depends on the parameter lambda. R is lambda minus 1 over 2, and summing up LP estimate and interpolation estimate and error estimate, finally we have the estimate of this form. So we now so please note that we now invoke that p is strictly greater than n. So p is strictly greater than n if and only if this exponent is negative. So by letting eta sufficiently large, so after taking a supremum with respect to x0, by letting eta sufficiently large so that the second term is observed into the left hand side, so we have we reach the goal. This is a sketch of the proof. So I have a remark about the Lauban boundary condition. So for the difference is for the Dirichlet boundary condition is Dirichlet boundary condition is preserved by a localization procedure. However, Robin boundary condition is not preserved in the localization. So if B satisfies the Robin boundary condition, then localized solution satisfies the inhomogeneous divergence, inhomogeneous boundary data. So K is error terms in the cutoff procedure. However, the estimate of fortunately, we have LP estimate for inhomogeneous boundary data proved by Professor Shibata and Shimada. So this term appears. And the estimate of K is the same with the estimate for G. So we observe that our argument applies to Robin boundary condition. So let me summarize my my talk. So the blow-up argument gives a stronger estimate. However, the angle is, blow-up argument just gives the angle positive angle. On the other hand, the direct approach gives clarifies the angle of analytic semigroup. But we cannot estimate the supernorm of second derivative terms. So I stop my talk here. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Are there any questions?